Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church this morning. Glad to see your smiling faces. Most of you are smiling, but thank you for the ones that are. We appreciate you. I'm glad you're here this morning. We're going to start off with a scripture reading from the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah 52, beginning in verse 6. Actually, Paul quotes this portion of scripture, or a little bit of it, in our reading in Romans today as well. Isaiah 52, 6 through 10. I think I'm a little hot here, guys. Therefore, my people shall know my name. Therefore, in that day, I am the one who is speaking. Here I am. How lovely on the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who announces peace and brings good news of happiness, who announces salvation and says to Zion, your God reigns. Listen, your watchmen lift up their voices. They shout joyfully together. For they will see with their own eyes when the Lord restores Zion. Break forth, shout joyfully together, you waste places of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. The Lord has bared his holy arm in the sight of all the nations, that all the ends of the earth may see the salvation of our God. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for today. Lord, I thank you for everyone that's here in your house. I thank you for those that are able to watch online. Lord Jesus, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would move and touch hearts today. Lord Jesus, many people have come this morning or tuned in that are had a rough week or struggling with something going on. But Lord Jesus, you are more than able. You are more than strong enough to touch us, to encourage us, to give us the strength and the energy we need, Lord Jesus. We just ask that you would come here as we praise your name and you would be in our midst as we lift you on high. You inhabit the praises of your people. We ask these things now in your name. Amen.
Well, good morning. All right, y'all have to just kind of bear with me now. I am a worship leader. That's just kind of who I am. That's kind of in my DNA. So I'm going to do worship leader kind of stuff here this morning. Just bear with me, okay, and understand this is who I am. Psalm 34. Verse 1, I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me and let's exalt his name together. It's easy to think about worship being the song we sing or that portion of the service that we do on a Sunday morning or when I put a CD in or I listen to some. That's not what worship is. Praising the Lord should be something that we continually do. And it's something that you have to be very deliberate about saying, I will praise the Lord in all things. Because as we saw even this week, even when God has a victory, and as we saw with the Supreme Court, the possibility that we have more choice, that maybe just a few more of those babies will be able to be born, and we can rejoice that God is still doing some work. The very next thing we hear is the violence and the anger and the vitriol and the terrible things that, and you're thinking, Satan really wanted to get that moment and not let us say, God is big, God is in control. That's how our whole life always goes, is that we have to understand that Satan is still working. But we have to watch for those times where God is bigger and God is greater. And we have to stop and say, thank you, God, for that. So I don't know today if you've come and you're having one of those days where there's things that have gone wrong. I know Billy needs to have a pat on the back just that he made it here this morning. Poor man. And Jane never seems to have a down moment. So the two of them balance each other out. But as we're going through just all of the different things that we deal with in life, Satan is always going to try to distract you from something good that God is doing. Never let him take that away from you. Always determine, I will praise the Lord. Continuously, his praise will be on my lips. Even in the midst of the distractions, God is still the biggest. So as we praise and worship this morning, whatever is distracting you, whatever is maybe coming in your mind that you're not thinking, or you're just a little bit, just decide today, I determine that I will praise the Lord. Let's stand together as we worship. We're going to sing A New Name Written Down in Glory. One of my favorite songs, and I play it way too fast, so you're probably going to have to make sure the dentures are adjusted in there so they don't come flying out when you're singing. But we have so much to just be thankful for and praise the Lord for. Even in today's society, we have so much to be grateful for. We have a God that loves us and that has redeemed us and that has called us his own and will never leave us. So let's sing out to him.
I was once a sinner. Forsaken, I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am.
Jesus Messiah.
Rescue for our sins. We have so much to be thankful for.
Yeah.
So, Father, as we stand in your presence this morning, thank you for opening the doors of heaven for us to come in before you and bow down and worship at your feet. You are worthy of our praise.
Yeah.
You are worthy of all that we have to give to you.
Yeah.
And as we just lift up our love and our praise and our devotion to you, we empty our hands and give you what bothers us and holds us back, Lord, so that you can fill us with yourself.
Amen.
Father, we just thank you. Thank you for this time we have together as a body to fellowship, to be as one crying, holy, holy is the Lord. We praise you and we thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated this morning.
I know we're here to praise the Lord, but I just want to say, you guys sounded really great today. Good job. I tell you, it's, Buster up there, boy, the sound, mixing it all together, good job. Tanner was right on target with the words, but I know we don't need all that to praise the Lord, right? We praise him no matter what, but I don't know about you guys. I just felt like, boy, they were not that you're bad any other time. But, it was on target.
Thank
this
you
morning.
For that qualifier right there.
We do have a few announcements for you. You got a couple different inserts in your bulletin. One is for volunteers for our Kids Crusade. It's kind of what we sometimes call VBS, really a Kids Crusade format where we're going to have a special speaker come in and do all kinds of anything from magic tricks to a lot of various different things he's going to do to help bring the message to the kids, and then we're going to have snacks afterwards. So it's a little bit different format than your normal VBS, but we still need some volunteers. Also, in the hallway in the back of me on the bulletin board is a chance if you would like to be able to donate for the snacks for this event. You can take little card that with you and sign up and let us know if you're going to be able to do that. We'd appreciate anybody that would like to help with that. That would be wonderful. Also, another insert is for this Saturday coming up. We are having dinner, aka supper, at 6 p.m. It's going to be a little different. Normally, we do a Sunday afternoon lunch, but we're doing, being July 4th weekend, we're going to do a cookout here on Saturday night. So please fill out that out and get it to Janet. She's in the nursery right now, so you can stop over there, or you can leave it in the offering plate, and I'll make sure that Janet and Ruth get that as well. I think you're supposed to mark on there if you want two hot dogs or you want a hot dog and a hamburger to go with it. So that is those inserts. Once again, a couple of other things coming up here. The ladies' Bible study will be starting on July 11th here at the church, 6:30 p.m. We're also starting children's church, which will be dismissed during the worship, right after the worship time is done. That'll be starting up next month, so that'll be next week as well. And we're asking the kids who are not nursery age to kind of hang out and hear with us as we sing, and then they can be dismissed to go back there then. The nursery will still be open as usual. Let's see. I'm trying to think if there's anything else that I'm missing here. Also, with the Kids Crusade, this is a It's designed to have families be here, so grandparents, parents, we'd love to have you join us. It's not required, unless you have a real younger kid. If you have a kid who's 3 years old and younger, we ask that they have somebody there to kind of accompany them and be with them during the kids' crusade. So hopefully, I think I got most of it covered for right now. Good enough for today. By way of note, immediately after the service, I'm going to be meeting with our board real quick. So if I disappear, it's not because I don't like you, okay? We're going to be stepping over into the choir room. No big mystery. We're looking at replacing the roof on the educational wing. It's in bad shape, and we just need to talk a couple details over before we do that. So you can certainly pray for the church, for the board to have some wisdom with that as well. I think that's about all I have for announcements. Just some prayer requests to be bringing to your attention. Audrey Bays' father, Philip Graham, is in the hospital right now, checking to see if he has AFib.
He does have AFib.
He has AFib.
Get medications and we'll be going home today.
Okay, so that's good. The good news is he's going home today, and so they know what the problem is, but I ask you to continue to pray for him for sure. Continue to pray for Margaret Arrington's great-grandson, Jude Bowman. He continued to have tests, and they're still finding some elevated enzymes, I guess is the way to say it, from his liver. I'm not sure exactly why that is, but please continue to pray for Jude. Appreciate your prayers there. Mike and Marcia Gobble asked for prayer for some neighbors of theirs down at the beach. Actually, there was three homes that caught fire and burned down there, and one of the homes was an elderly couple, and they had to jump off like a balcony or a deck to escape the fire, and they had some burns, so be praying for them especially. I'm sure this couple would appreciate your prayers for healing there. Is there any other prayer requests that we can make mention of this morning? John Dugan. Thank you, God, for what he has been doing there in his life. But have an unspoken this morning? I'd just like the Lord to move in your life for sure. He sees that. He knows what's on your heart. Well, we're going to be singing our prayer hymn in just a moment. Please know the altars are open. Come and seek the Lord. He will be found if you seek him.
This is probably one of my favorite hymns. I say that, and there's probably like 18 of them that are my favorites. And then there's about 87 that are my good hymns. And then there's like two that I don't particularly love. But, you know, this one I love because it just is that quiet time where we can just be one-on-one with God. And I love going back in the Psalms and listening to David, because there's times where David just pours out his heart to God. And he doesn't have to be all fancy and say the right things and do that. He just comes to God like, I'm wanting to be with you and talk to you about things. And guess what, God? I'm angry about this, and I'm frustrated with this, and I don't like that, and I praise you for this. And he just runs the whole gamut in all of his psalms. Because God is interested in our hearts. And in this, in the garden, it's to me that wherever that quiet place is that you like to be able to say, this is my time with you, God. This is my quiet moment. This is where I don't have to be who everybody else looks at me to see who I am. This is who I really am, who you made and you understand. And I can just be myself with you, Lord. So as we sing this morning, would you just take that moment to just be with the Lord? Let's stand together as we sing.
Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord God, for meeting us here today. We thank you that you do walk with us, Lord Jesus, through this life, and that truly your children are never alone. You are always with us, Lord Jesus. What a wonderful and beautiful promise, Lord Jesus. Lord, we lift up some folks that just need your touch this morning. I thank you for the good news there with Philip. Lord Jesus, I pray that you would continue to touch him, and as he's going home, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would help bring this AFib into under control, Lord. I pray for little Jude, Lord Jesus. I pray for his liver there. You know what's going on, Lord Jesus, and you can bring healing. Where the doctors may not have answers, you do. So I pray your touch over him, Lord. I thank you for the, Lord Jesus, the good report for Marcia's brother-in-law there, Lord Jesus. We pray that you continue to work in his life, to continue to open his heart. He's opened John's heart to you, Lord Jesus. We pray for the Gobble's neighbors down there in on the beach, Lord Jesus, and thank you, Lord Jesus, that they were able to escape and get out. Lord, we pray for your continued healing, Lord Jesus, as they did suffer some burns there, Lord. We pray you continue to help them, Lord Jesus, in this recovery process, Lord. Lord, we just also think right now of everything that's going on in our nation. We do rejoice and thank you, Lord Jesus, for the truth that, Lord Jesus, all life matters to you, Lord Jesus, and that we should protect all life. I think that that is coming forward, and even science itself is confirming, Lord Jesus, what you say in your word. But Lord, we pray right now for peace in our nation. I pray for protection. I pray that those that would think that violence would further their cause or further their idea, Lord Jesus, that you would speak to their hearts and bring that calm and peace, Lord Jesus, and that, Lord God, we would always not get to the level where we're physically attacking others to advance our cause, Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray for our service now. I just ask that you would continue to meet us, Lord Jesus, through the special music here and through the word, that you would be alive and active in our lives through this ministry time. In your name, amen.
glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder,
and keeps us breathless in awe and wonder.
The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. Unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing, Lord, all that you've done for me.
I told you they were on point today. aren't they? Good job. Thank you for your ministry. Before I jump into the sermon, obviously there's been a lot of talk about this decision, Roe v. Wade, and you know, North Carolina still now it's kind of in their hands, and we don't know what's going to happen in this state. Certainly prayer is a part of that as well. But a lot of folks have been saying, we need to be part of the church, should be part of something positive to help out and reach out and help young mothers, and we are to a degree. It would be certainly great if we were more. If you are interested in anything like that, the organization that we filled the baby bottles up for does all sorts of help and ministry to young families, and also they do post-abortion counseling. One of the things that they don't tell you when you get abortion is the physical, emotional, and spiritual trauma that you suffer. And they actually spend probably more time in that ministry than they do anything else, trying to help women who have been through, their grandparents who have been through that, fathers who have been through that as well. So there is a positive thing that we can get involved in and do, and I hope every year we do that baby bottle ministry. As long as I'm here, I'm planning on doing that, but I think there's also other practical options that we can do to actually get involved with that ministry. If you're interested in that, I'd be happy to talk with you more about that. We're going to jump into Romans chapter 10. I feel like Romans is kind of now the place we go in between the holidays. There's so many coming up next week, 4th of July, so I don't know yet if we're going to be in Romans or a special sermon. The Lord decide that this week, but Romans 10, verses 11 through 17. For the Scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. First of all, let's just stop and think about that just for a second. Whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. For whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And those capitalized ones are when he quotes the Old Testament. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? How will they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. However, they did not all heed the good news, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. What a poetic statement the Bible makes, beginning with Isaiah. How beautiful are the feet of the one who brings good news. That's the name of my sermon, Beautiful Feet. It almost sounds like it should be one of those hippie songs from the 60s, right? Beautiful feet. And while this is certainly a prophecy of Jesus, who brought the good news more than Jesus did? And how beautiful is every aspect, including his feet, right? But Paul lets us know here that it applies to every believer who shares the good news. And it's not that the feet are literally beautiful to the eyes. I'm sure there have been a few people through the years who had pretty ugly feet that shared the good news of salvation in Jesus Christ. And God still thought they have beautiful feet. I'm so glad that, you know, I don't have to show you my feet this morning, so you can judge whether they're beautiful or not. We'll let my wife be the one alone judge on that. So she's the only one that has to see them on a regular basis. But this is a poetic saying. Maybe we could say it like this. There are no greater heroes in heaven than those who share the good news. Or maybe like this. How blessed are the tires of those who bring good news. They didn't have tires back then, right? How holy are those instruments that take us to the place where we can share the good news. How blessed are those who visit the sick in the hospital and remind them that Jesus died for them. How sacred are those who sit in a class of children and teach them the truths of the Bible. How blessed are those who get on social media and share that Jesus is the answer. How wonderful are the vocal cords of those who sing his praises in the midst of even those who don't believe. How amazing are those who lovingly stand up for Christ in a hostile world. How tremendous are those who invite their friend to church or to a Bible study or even just to read a book pointing people to Jesus. The Bible here tells us that God sees even the feet of those who would walk to bring the good news to someone. They're special and blessed. If your feet are, imagine the rest of you. How special and blessed for those who will bring the good news. Well, let's jump in to this idea of beautiful feet. My first point is that there is no substitute for the good news. He is the answer. Once again, verse 11 of what I just read, for the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed. I'm so glad he doesn't put that pressure on anyone else. Okay? Whoever believes in the president will not be disappointed. Well, almost guaranteed you probably will be. Whoever believes in the governor, or whoever believes in the pastor, or whoever believes in this, no, it's him and him alone will not be disappointed. And that is the only good news. He also says here, faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. Christ is the center of this good news. No other word, no other way, no other path, no other message, no other good news. We preach Christ. We preach his crucifixion, his resurrection, his plan of salvation, and his soon return. And any means we use are blessed. Stories, illustrations, parables, testimonies, videos, books, blogs, songs, sermons, there are all ways we share the truth of Christ. But they themselves are not the truth of Christ. They don't replace the truth of Christ. And we do more than just preach some good morals. We do much more than just try to help this, make this place, the world we live in, a little better. Obviously, the good news can do that. If everybody's living by the way Christ taught, the world would be a better place. But we do more than that. We do much more than just try to be a good example, even. We have to share the good news. See, the good news needs to be shared. If I have good news and you just see a smile on my face, you're not going to know what that good news is until I tell you what it is, right? Imagine, this just come to me, this illustration, so I don't know if it's going to make sense or not. You got to be careful when something just comes to you. You better listen to the Holy Spirit, right? So imagine that one of my sons comes home and says, Dad, I'm going to get married. And rather than tell my wife the good news, I just smile at her and act real happy. She'd be like, what are you smiling at, you big goofball? Someone has to tell her the good news. Otherwise, you don't know what the good news is. So the good news has to be more than just an example. Here's kind of a really crazy example I did come up with this week. My mind is a little warped, so excuse me. But if people are walking toward an area where there's a giant T-Rex, now they don't exist anymore, and that's probably a good thing, even though they're on the movies, but just imagine, okay, this is for one of my sons who's a big Jurassic Park fan. Imagine that they're walking and there's a big, huge T-Rex and he's eating people down in that direction. And we knew that up ahead was a safe house where they had big tanks to protect people from that T-Rex. We would fall short of our job if we saw people walking towards that T-Rex and we just smiled. We walk the other direction. We're going to be a good example. We're showing them if we walk in this direction, that this is the right direction. But we don't tell them there's a huge, giant T-Rex that's going to eat you up ahead. But over this way is the way to escape it. I know it's a little crazy, right? Maybe we'd even do the right thing. We say, I'm going to do the right thing. I'm going to give them a little granola bar so that along the way they don't get tired before they get eaten by the T-Rex. If we don't bring the news that mankind is lost in their sins, then headed for eternal destruction, let alone earthly suffering, and that Jesus has provided a way to not only escape this, but to live eternally secure and have peace and joy, and all we do is try to be nice and give them a couple of bucks along the way, what does that say? That's not the good news. Now, that said, I don't think you should be purposely a jerk when you share the good news either. A little kindness helps people hear the good news, right? But we have to share the one message that will bring eternal change to our eternal destiny. Once again, this does not mean we don't win some people with kindness and compassion. We do. We also need to live a life that demonstrates we have Christ in us. We do need to have an example in our life. But us being perfect isn't going to win anyone. When we share, we are sinners saved by grace. Like John Wesley said, he was a brand plucked from the fire. and that Jesus saved us from our own eternal destiny of hell and suffering and made a way through his blood to make a new eternal destiny for us in heaven. That is the good news that the Bible is talking about. In the end, we're not trying to get people to join an organization like our organization, or maybe we want them to not join the church down the street, but to join our church. Or to think, wow, they're really great people. The good news is that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. That is what we share. Sometimes the church can get trapped, and I say the church in general, the evangelical church even, and we've, I think, entered into an era where it's slipping into this old trap, and it's not a new trap, of preaching things that kind of avoid the very core of the Bible. They don't even address this. And unfortunately, sometimes I've turned into some sermons online or even on television, and they don't even mention Jesus. How can you bring the good news of Jesus Christ if you don't even say his name? You know, a lot of the sermons out there, 10 steps to a happier life, finding your true identity in Christ, your best life now, how to get out of debt and stay out of debt. I'm not saying there's no value in some of these subjects. In fact, some of them there are. It's true some of these subjects can be springboards also to talk about Jesus and giving your life to him. But sadly, as I listen to many, there's little mention of surrender to Christ or following him or repenting and turning to him. It's just some practical advice, which is good, probably. It's not evil, but it falls short of the good news the Bible is talking about. Let me just say it this way. There will be people in heaven that heard the good news that had debt out their ears and could never get past it. And unfortunately, there'll be people in hell that were completely out of debt. Okay? Now, I don't, being out of debt is a good thing, and the Bible teaches be careful, don't go into debt, and et cetera, et cetera. You know, especially, you know, don't be a slave to the debtor. I understand that's a good biblical principle. But if you don't put Jesus in there and the good news and the forgiveness that he brings and that we need to give our lives to him, then it's just good advice. It is Jesus who does not disappoint people. I want people to seek his face, to grow in him, to share him with others. He said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me. He is the good news. He should be the center of our message. His word should be the basis not only of our message, but our life. So the second point then is, who will bring the good news? Here's the real meat of the message, everyone. So if you only hear one thing this morning, let it be this. We are all called to bring the good news. But wait a minute, it says there in Romans, how will they hear without a preacher? And you're the preacher, so you're the one that's supposed to bring the good news, Preacher Martin. Well, the word preacher there can be just as easily translated messenger. We have all been given a message and entrusted with a message to share. Now, that doesn't mean everybody has to get up behind a pulpit and speak to a church. That's not what preaching means in this situation. It means that God has given you a message. It starts with John 3:16. You only have to know one Bible verse to be able to give this message to others. You actually only have to be able to tell people, I gave my life to Jesus and he made a difference in me to be able to give this message. So I think next time someone calls me Preacher Marty, I'm going to say, call you Preacher too. And I'll say, okay, Preacher Reggie, Preacher Chase. Preacher Gina, right? Everybody's looking at me like, what? Don't call my name. All right, I'll stop there. Not everyone is called and gifted to be a great evangelist. I understand that. Not everyone is called to get up here and bring the message. Not everyone is called to start a YouTube channel to start teaching God's word. Not everyone is called to stand in the street corner like that guy with a bullhorn or to hand out tracts at the local mall. Not everyone is called to strike a conversation with the checker at Walmart on their eternal destination. My mom could do that. You know, she'd start talking to the lady at Walmart about whether or not she knew Jesus or not, and I'd be like, oh, and I just feel like I'm serving the Lord good if I make eye contact and say good morning. So, but we are all called in some way to share our faith in Christ, to share the good news that Jesus has saved us. Here's a verse for regular people, okay? Maybe you're not called to do any of those things. But Peter says in his first book, 1 Peter 3:15, always be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. As a Christian, if we've been transformed by Christ and the good news has affected us, part of our responsibility is to be ready at any time God brings someone our way to at least be able to share a couple of verses and to tell others, this is what Jesus has done for me. Jesus has changed my life. I have faith in him, and he has made all the difference. That's what a testimony is, okay? You don't have to be a theologian to be able to share that. And sometimes people, well, what if they ask me this question or that question? Well, you've got one or two or three options if they ask you something you don't understand. You can go research it. You can look it up. So make sure you look it up on a good site. Find a couple of good sites. And the third one is, that's what the vice chairman of the board is for. So you just go and ask Billy, and he'll be able to give you the answer. No, I'm just joking. You can come and ask the pastor, and sometimes I'll be happy that the pastor, someone I know I'm trying to share my faith with, ask me a hard question. What do I say to him? And I can do my best to help you too. You have options there. Sometimes that's going to happen, but that shouldn't prevent you from sharing the good news. It's everyone's job. After Stephen was stoned and persecution came upon the church, we read in Acts 8:1. Says, there arose in that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. But then what did those believers who scattered, what did they do? Acts 4 tells us. Now those who were scattered about went evangelizing or preaching. It says preaching, some, the word in the Greek is evangelizomenio, so that's where some versions say evangelizing. They went about evangelizing or preaching the word. They went about sharing the gospel with others. Okay, it didn't take the apostles. The apostles kind of stuck with Jerusalem. But all the other people went out and they kept sharing the word. We don't know their names. But the Bible makes clear one thing. They have beautiful feet. Okay? They brought the message. They brought the good news where they were scattered, where they went. Noted historian Kenneth Scott Latourette makes this observation about the spread of the gospel. He says, the chief agents in the expansion of Christianity appear not to have been those who made it a profession or a major part of their occupation, but rather men and women who earned their livelihood in some other purely secular manner and spoke of their faith to those whom they met in this natural fashion. I'm going to try to put it plainly. That was a little scholarly way to say it. He's saying this. Yes, people like Peter and Paul and James and John and Philip and Stephen preached and they brought some people to the Lord. But the good news spread because those people then led some people to faith in Christ. And then those people did the same thing and led some more people to Christ. And then those people led some other people to Christ until eventually we get here to Central Wesleyan Church in Thomasville. And somebody led you and me to Christ. Sometimes it might be a preacher, pastor who, you know, does it and spends their life doing it. But most often, it was just another believer. Just another believer. Here's just, as we're thinking about four things to share when you share with the good news. First, God's plan to bring life and not death. People want to know what's all the suffering in the world. Well, that's not God. That's Satan. God's plan is to bring life and life more abundantly. The second thing to share is that we have a problem. We were born with a nature that rebels against God and is heading for death. God calls this sin. And one of the reasons we see so much evil and suffering in the world is because mankind is born into sin. The third thing to share is God's remedy, and that's the cross. That Jesus took the penalty for our sins. And the fourth thing is our response, and that is to believe in Jesus. Put your life in his hands. Give your life to him. And once again, if nothing else, at least you can share, this is what Jesus has done for me. This is how he brought me out of the sin, out of the miry muck, and set my feet on a good place. Well, it brings me to my third and final point as we think about beautiful feet. There, I got some beautiful feet. I looked on the internet for the most beautiful feet I could find, and that was about all I could get. So, you know, when you do an internet search, you kind of got to be careful, right? You start looking at beautiful feet, and you don't know what you're going to find. So it's good to have a good filter on your search engine there. But those were the most beautiful feet I could find. My third point is that serving Jesus is what it is all about. I want to challenge us with this as we think of these beautiful feet and what it means to us. We get so caught up in everything around us that we forget why we are here. Are we here on this earth to play video games? The Bible doesn't say how beautiful are the thumbs that can press 5 buttons at once. Are we here on this earth to build a large portfolio so we can retire in leisure? How beautiful are the dollars of those who invest well? Are we here on the earth to sit around watching sports all the time? How beautiful are the backsides of those who watch thousands of hours of games? Are we here to entertain ourselves with endless movies or podcasts or love songs or romance novels? How beautiful are the eyes of those who grow dim staring at a screen? Are we here to work hard and accomplish, to work the most and to work the hardest? How beautiful are the feet of those who step on others climbing the ladder of success? Are we here just to make it to the next vacation? How beautiful are the tires that wear out with trips to the beach? Now, I'm not saying any of those things are bad, and I'm not trying to bring a guilt trip on anybody, because we all need a little bit of relaxation, a little bit of getting away from the grind of life. We all have to have, it helps to have a couple hobbies. It's good to have good friendships and relationships that we build. And sometimes those hobbies and those interests that we have help us reach and relate with people, okay? In other words, if you like basketball a lot, maybe the fact that other people like basketball is someone that you can share the gospel, the good news with. But these things are not our purpose. We as Christians should know it the best. These things will disappoint. Not one time does it say that these things won't disappoint. It only says Christ will not disappoint. As a Cubs fan, I can tell you, they will disappoint. My goodness, one World Series in 100 and something years will tell you they will disappoint. Life is full of disappointments. Jesus is the one that won't. Jesus doesn't disappoint when we surrender it all to him. So the feet of those who tell others about him, those are what the Bible calls beautiful. Serving Jesus is everyone's calling, and it's where it's at. I'm going to tell you what Jesus has done for us. I talked earlier about just letting people know what Jesus means to you. In my life and in our life, every time we've done something a bit scary, maybe that's required a bit of sacrifice in our world to serve him, every time there were way more blessings at the end than if we had held back. In every way, spiritual blessings, family blessings, even financial blessings. I have found that when I serve him and step out in faith and do what he's called me to do, to share the good news in whatever way he's called me to, God has found my lowly, stinking feet to be beautiful and has blessed me. This is why I say serving Jesus is where it is at. Now, at times, of course, we've had hardship. Everyone does. We've had hard work along the way. Things didn't go the way we thought they would. But at the end of each road, I can see that serving God, well, my steps were truly blessed. And that's what I want for you. The Bible says, rejoice for the steps of a righteous person. They are ordered of God. There is not a better path to pick than to give yourself to serving him in whatever special way he has for you to serve him. I'm not saying everybody should be a pastor or a preacher. Not everyone should adopt kids. Not everyone should homeschool. Not everyone should move a different side of the country. I'm saying whatever he has for you. Your own place, your own time of life. I was thinking about this, trying to think of a hip, cool way to say it, but then I realized that depending on your age, it was all different on how you would say it. So, you know, for you Gen Xers, that's me, serving Jesus is the bomb, okay? For you Gen Zers, I don't even know what this means. I had to ask my kids, but serving Jesus is POG, it's poggers to serve Jesus. I don't know what poggers means. Probably the fact that I don't know what it means is why it's cool. How about you baby boomers out there? Serving Jesus is far out. It's groovy, guys, really. You millennials, serving Jesus is fire. How about all you seniors out there? Serving Jesus is the bee's knees. Whatever your job is, wherever you end up living, wherever your financial or marital state is, whatever age you are, whatever is going on in the political world around you, serving Jesus is where you will find purpose. And when you store up, and that, it's by serving him that you store up eternal treasure in heaven. It cannot be touched by anything the world throws at it. Colossians 3:24 says that knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. It is from the Lord Christ whom you serve. Our eternal inheritance is coming through service to him. Let me close with this, and that is that God is not so concerned about the outward beauty of your feet, but what you do with your feet. Your feet may be cracked, crooked, calloused, and full of corns, but if they carry the good news of God and God's saving message, then in the eyes of God, your feet are beautiful. Pastor David Strem once said, the Hebrew word for beautiful is nahad. And it does not mean pretty or cute. It means befitting, becoming, appropriate, used as designed, perfectly fitting. It is what God had in mind for our feet. The same way grapes were designed to be eaten and flowers were meant to bring color and scent to our world, your feet are designed to take you different places. And when they go into the world of men and women with the message of the good news and the peace with God is possible, God calls them beautiful. Your feet may take you faster down the racetrack than anyone else. You may have shoes so big that other people cannot fill them. You may be able to kick the ball farther than anyone else, but that means nothing in the eternal frame. But if your feet take you to someone in need, and with God's help, you enable this person to walk with God, then your feet are being used for the purpose that matters for all eternity, and those feet are beautiful. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I pray for your people today. Lord, I pray that they would be reminded, Lord Jesus, of the purpose we're here, the reason you gave us feet, the reason you gave us voice, the reason you gave us energy and time is to share that good news with others. Lord Jesus, and not, I don't want anyone to walk away today feeling guilty, but Lord Jesus, this is the purpose that you've given us. And so we will find fulfillment as we fulfill that purpose. So Lord Jesus, just speak with your people. Give us opportunities to share the good news, Lord Jesus, and in that your Holy Spirit would help us share the right good news in the right way with the right people. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. May God bless you.